Ladies and gentlemen, once again, good morning, Barcelona. Those of you that were here in this fantastic tech digital extravaganza yesterday, if you enjoyed what you heard, what you experienced yesterday, I am sure you're going to enjoy it today, because we're going to do it all over again today, naturally, from top to bottom, and naturally again tomorrow as well. Let me firstly introduce myself. Those of you that weren't here yesterday, my name is Peter Hopwood. I am a communications public speaking coach, so I help people tell lots of stories, tell them better. And let me tell you, for today and tomorrow, you're going to hear again lots of different wonderful stories that are going to inspire you and give you maybe the edge that you need when you go back to your offices, maybe at the end of the week or next week, in fact. Okay, let's kick off with our very first keynote main speaker today. Now, looking at this screen here, the future of all things and the creation of time. Now, that's a mighty title, isn't it? A mighty title for a keynote speech. But hopefully, I'm sure the gentleman on stage who's going to share that with you will certainly be able to make sense of that and give you everything you need to really get value out of this session. Okay, so it's a gentleman that's considered actually one of the key figures in the industry in terms of the clarity, depth, and breadth of his vision. A man who combines his vision with the power of Bell Labs to create a unique innovation engine whose goal it is to invent the future of the networking and communications industry. So you'll agree with me, a man who certainly knows what he's talking about. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for the president of Nokia Bell Labs and chief technology officer of Nokia, Mr. Marcus Weldon.
Thank you very much. Hi, everyone. It's good to be here in Barcelona. I'm going to talk about, I mean, it's a crazy title, right? If I actually manage to tell you about the future of all things and the creation of time in 25 minutes, that'll be amazing. But let me suggest that it might be possible, right? Because I run this organization called Bell Labs. Those of you who are younger than me, which is probably most of you, Bell Labs is that place that invented pretty much everything you've ever used. And let me just give you a list. It invented the transistor, so that means every digital processor that is about your person or in your lives based on transistors. There's 1 × 10^21 transistors in the world, a number known as 1 sextillion. So that is a pretty important thing we invented. We invented Unix, C, C++, lasers, wireless communications, solar cells, CCD cameras, which are the basis of your cell phone camera. And we did it all following roughly the type of formula I'm going to show you today. The way we work is this. We think 5 years out, maybe even 10 years out. And then we try and think about what are human needs on that time scale. So we think about what are the fundamental human needs of people, industry, because we all live in a work and a home environment. And then think about what are the technological limits that exist. And then we try to solve those problems. So the talk today is really about, we all understand the future isn't just about normal human interactions, it's about things. It's the future of all things. But the goal of the future, and this is an interesting one that's a bit different from the past, is the goal is to create time. And that's what the Internet of Things is all about. And the fundamental value of the future is about creating time. So I'm going to go through that. Hopefully you'll have some fun. We're going to talk Star Trek, by the way. So are there any Star Trek fans here? A reasonable number, so the talk will not be lost on you, but we're going to get to Star Trek as well. So let's start with that idea of creating time. Now, there's three basic ways. If people can think of other ways, shout them out. But these are my three. Change time through relativistic type things. So if you want to play with relativity, you play with differences in gravity and velocity, you can actually create time that way. For example, astronauts circling the globe in the space station, if they're up there for 6 months, they come down 5 milliseconds younger than the people on Earth. But that's not really interesting. 5 milliseconds younger probably doesn't make you look much more attractive. But you can see that, so it's not really a productive way. If I'm going to talk about creating time, 5 milliseconds is not going to be that interesting. Second, I could change people's lifetimes, right? And so I could discover either the fountain of youth or what you consider sort of the bio equivalent these days of genetically engineer or find some new physiological medicine that allows me to extend life. I'm not going to talk about that one either. We are actually working on that in Bell Labs, but that's a whole other story. So the one I'm going to talk about is change how we use time. And if we do that and create efficiency in how we process information, how we live our lives, we're effectively creating time. Okay? So here we go. We're going to talk about number three. So this is a famous thing called Maslow's hierarchy of human needs. It's a piece of psychology from the 1950s. It's been updated. But its basic premise is pretty simple. The stuff at the bottom, and if you can read it, the stuff at the bottom is sort of mundane human tasks like food, air, water, etc., is where you want to spend the least amount of time because they're considered mundane survival tasks. And at the top is where you want to spend the most amount of time because they're the satisfaction, learning, knowledge, aesthetic tasks. So that's what the hierarchy says. And basically Maslow says, don't spend too much time down there, otherwise you'll be dissatisfied, you're just struggling to survive. Try and spend as much time at the top and you'll feel fulfilled. The very top is actually fulfilling others. Transcendence, or what it's called here, transcendence is where you actually teach other people. So that's considered the highest level of human achievement. So if you think about it, that's all about time savings. I want to spend less time at the bottom, more time at the top. So if I can find ways to do that, I am fundamentally satisfying human need, okay? By the way, this is where our industry, I'm in telecom obviously, our industry has the following role in this hierarchy. And you're all laughing, but you all know it's true, right? Our networking industry has actually become so fundamental that it's essentially considered the zeroth level of the hierarchy, is that you want to spend no time figuring out how to optimize your connectivity, but it's fundamental to you. So free Wi-Fi has become a metaphor for the value of the industry we're in, but also the fact it's devalued a bit currently relative to some of the other things. So the story I'm going to tell you is that we're going to create new value in this industry that actually is tremendous opportunity for us all. So that's where we're going. Okay, so that's Maslow. So that's the human value. There's a business value of time, of course. It's not this human value. This all seems a bit nice that I want to live a more satisfied, aesthetic life. But there's a business value of time. But this is one of the big conundrums that exists today. This is a book called... Or taken from a book by Robert Gordon called The Rise and Fall of American Growth. This is data he shows in productivity. This is people productivity in each of these eras. And what he shows is it's plateaued. These are all increases, by the way. They're all increases, so it keeps going up. But the big growth, the big increase in productivity was in the Industrial Revolution era and in the Internet era, or the sort of the last digital era that we've just left. He says productivity actually has plateaued. It's still increasing, but not as fast. And he says this for a couple of reasons. One is we just move things around. What we've done, if you think about it, is we've distributed where we do things, but we haven't necessarily created new value. He points out that now 20 to 30% of companies spend money on IT, spend their R&D or their OPEX on IT, which used to be manufacturing tasks, right, inside a factory. They used to own factories and facilities, and now they just spend it on IT. They've offshored everything. So they've outsourced many of the functions, but that's relatively inefficient. So we've actually distributed, but not created new value. We thought it was right to break it apart into pieces and spread it around the globe, but in fact, it's not created the same productivity. So this is a loss of business value relative to where we would like to be or where we were during the industrial era. So think of this as the goal here, if you think about it, is if you increase the rate, so seconds or inverse seconds is the rate of something, rate of productivity. If I increase rate of productivity, the amount of time I take to do a task goes down. So there's a business value of time, and we all know that. But the quest we have here is to try and find if we're actually going to increase productivity in future or not. Gordon actually argues it's never going to happen again. This was just a bizarre era of the Industrial Revolution. It's never going to happen again. I'm here to tell you it's going to happen again. It's going to be to do with optimizing how we sense the world, how we think about the world, and how we take actions upon the world. Okay, so that's the business value of time. So let's think about how well we've done as humans. These are three examples where humans have done phenomenal things that essentially increase our usage of time. So the first one is a wheel. It's a bit of an old wheel, but you could argue that wheels increased our ability to, or the rate at which we could go from one place to another by a factor of 100, planes by a factor of 500, printing machines, that's a printing machine, increased our, the rate at which we could produce written materials, printed materials by a factor of 1,000, and telescopes, that's the Hubble, increased our ability to see by a factor of 1,000. So what you can summarize this by saying is we've continuously created tools that actually help augment our physical abilities. Each of these is a physical task. Moving by road or by air, printing, used to be writing, and then seeing, and now we see with telescopes, right? So in doing so, we created time, right? Because when the rate goes up, the time taken to do it goes down. So we're gonna play with that a little bit. So that's what we've done so far. It's pretty good. But beyond those sort of physical tasks, what have these web companies done? So Google, Facebook, Amazon, Apple, what have they done? They have increased things. What have they increased? I would argue that what they've done is increase our ability to discover things, and in doing so, save time. I would also maybe argue increase our ability to waste time. But you get the value, right? If we're going through sort of a value argument here, the early things, the wheel, the plane, the printing press, telescopes increased our ability to do things at distance and save time. These companies helped us to discover things. So what did we discover? We discovered information, Google, social connections, Facebook, Amazon, goods that we wanted delivered, and Apple, of course, was anything using a mobile device. So we increased our ability to discover, and we saved time in the process. Because otherwise, what would we have to do? You have to go to a library instead of Google. Facebook is an interesting one because we had to recover a function we'd lost, which is we used to meet like this, and that was relatively efficient. Then we separated, and we needed a way to meet again. So they solved a problem that we had actually created by dispersing geographically. Amazon, because it was never really inefficient to walk around stores and hope they had the thing you wanted, so they optimized the supply demand of commerce. And then Apple, as I said, was attached to mobile networks. You could access anything from anywhere on a smartphone. So this is interesting. We kept coming back to this theme of value creation is about saving time, whether it's from shortening distances or increasing our ability to discover. So let's go to Star Trek. I promised Star Trek. Let's see how Star Trek's doing. Why do I bring up Star Trek? Future thinking, even at Bell Labs, is often augmented by thinking science fiction thoughts, right? Because where is the best future thinking done? It's actually not by us, typically. It's by creative thinkers about the future of the human condition. So let's do Star Trek thinking. Now, Star Trek, of course, started, 1950s? So it's sort of a bit backwards thinking to the future. But they still thought of some things we haven't been able to do. But let's go through the ones we have been able to do. So you remember what this thing is, the communicator, right? That is a smartphone. In fact, I would argue we outdid the communicator, because the communicator, you could only talk. You couldn't, there was no such thing as apps that you could use on the communicator. So we beat that. But Star Trek predicted it would exist probably 20, 30 years before we actually had smartphones. Next one, the holodeck. Do you remember this one? Those of you who've seen Star Trek Next Generation, it wasn't the original series. You enter this room that was a blank room, and it transformed into whatever you asked it to be. You would talk to it and say, I want to be in the Amazonian rainforest, and it would transform into that. Well, essentially, that's virtual reality, right? We could actually do it in 360-degree rooms, but we thought that probably the right way to do it is virtual reality. So we've solved that one recently, but only recently. Next one, replicator. Do you remember this one? Who remembers the replicator? Replicator made food on demand, right? You went up to it and said, I want this, and it would make you steak. But that's a 3D printer. In fact, 3D printers can print food, and they can print other things. So I'd say we've probably done better on the other things, not so good on food, but we've created a replicator function. So we've solved three of the Star Trek conundrums. But there's two that we haven't solved yet. We haven't solved for yet. So let's do those. And by the way, I can characterize these things the same way. These decrease our distance. It's quite clear, communications over distance. Holodeck, I don't have to go there, or virtual reality, I don't get it. Replicator, I don't have to go to a factory or a restaurant, I can have it created there. Decrease distance, but also decrease the amount of wasted your energy, because these things are optimized. I don't have to travel, save on travel costs. I don't have to actually have excess production of something. If I've got a 3D printer, I just print the good I want. So again, it's reducing distance, but also reducing waste, and again, saving time. So the two that we haven't solved for in Star Trek. You remember these? Transporter. That's where you went fuzzy and you ended up on another planet. Right, that one is hard. I call that one a hard problem. And the tricorder was you scanned by the doctor who was called Bones. He scanned you and he told you exactly what was wrong with you, with that thing, which looks a bit like a slot machine, but it was a small thing and it scanned you up and down. So those two are hard, but those are the only two we haven't solved for, but what I'm gonna argue is the network we're gonna build, the digital fabric of the future that we're going to build together with new applications, new services, actually attempts to solve these two problems. Think about it, why? The transporter's job was to make you experience something remotely, efficiently, and the thought that Star Trek writers had was you actually had to beam down to that location to experience it. But in fact, if I can encapsulate an experience in one location and send that experience to another person, I'm essentially transporting them. And to some extent, virtual reality plays a role there, but think of it as fully multi-sensory, all the senses transported, then I don't actually need to be there, I just need to feel like I'm there. And the tricorder was a hard one because it requires, of course, deep physiology and learning about the human condition, but with all the advent of smart devices and even, you know, there's now artificial skin and artificial clothing and embedded sensors in clothing, we're gonna essentially be able to probably do the tricorder. But in order to do that, we need advances and we need new knowledge creation tools, et cetera. So I would argue that these, again, will decrease distance, increase knowledge this time, and that's the interesting one. I'm gonna come back to that. Increase knowledge, understanding, and in doing so, we will create time. So that's our era. The era I want you to remember is we are in the era where we're going to create knowledge and also be able to take actions based on that knowledge, and that will be through software and hardware, robots and remote control things. So knowledge creation, robotics, that's where we're going in this era, okay? So you're already beginning to see where I'm going. So, to summarize in pictures, and then I'll show you how we're gonna do it, because it wouldn't be much fun if I was just going to tell you what the problem is and not tell you how to answer it. So we need to interface our digital and physical realms to decrease the distance. And that was actually meant to say decrease distance and waste, comma, and create time. Not to say decrease distance and waste and create time. Commas matter sometimes. But you get the idea. The idea is we will decrease distance between things because we'll be able to remotely see, interface, touch, control. When we do that, we don't have to consume resources in the same way. And so it's more efficient in energy consumption and time consumption. So that's what we've got to do. Think of that. That is essentially the description of IoT and, in some ways, artificial intelligence. We're trying to actually touch the physical or interconnect the digital and the physical realms. But there's a really important other idea. So that might just be that we touch these things, we allow them to communicate, but this is an important one. We have never augmented our mental abilities up to this point. Machine learning, deep learning, also invented at Bell Labs, by the way, was one attempt at that, and it's become recently relatively successful for a limited number of tasks, facial recognition, audio recognition, because essentially has to train on well-defined data sets, and then you can replicate that. But in general, over the history of humankind, we have not increased our ability to think. And I often ask people, when you want to think about a problem, what do? And most people say they go to a whiteboard, or they go to a pen and paper or pencil and paper. So for all these remarkable physical distance shrinking things we've done that have allowed us to save time or create efficiency in discovery, we haven't increased our ability to think. So the era we're entering has to solve for that problem, okay? So we're gonna increase our ability to acquire knowledge, do it over distance, any distance, and that's why IoT comes in, and in doing so, we're gonna save time. Makes sense so far? The reason I tell you this, by the way, is if you think about it this way, judge anything you do in the future by whether it saves time or not. So if I go back to my Google example, for example, I think we'd all agree Google saves time, but we'd all say Facebook, maybe, maybe not, right? It does help me connect with people, but maybe I don't really need to connect with the people that I'm connected with, and maybe what they have to say isn't that interesting. So you can see that the value equation of Facebook is a little bit different, but then when they start adding in other values, messenger services, communication services, news services, when it's the right news, not the wrong news, that's adding more value because aggregating things for me, saving me time. Amazon, we'd all agree, saves me time because I don't have to go to the store. So you can start parsing that way. I'm gonna do one more before we go on. Autonomous vehicles, what is the point of autonomous vehicle? It's not more fun to drive, right? It doesn't go any faster, might go a little faster. It actually saves you time because you can now perform another task while it's moving. Equally, if it doesn't is not prone to as many accidents, then you're saving human lifetime or the time delay due to crashes and accidents, right? So those are all time-saving vehicles. But let's, I want to go back a little bit to show just how special this time is, and then I'm going to tell you how to build time. This is how special the time is. Economists define an era like this as a technological revolution. And their definition of a technological revolution is this. You need to invent a new technology. Makes sense. You need to network it. Why? Networking effects give you that N squared. It's called Metcalfe's law. The power of the value of something goes up in proportion to the square of the number of things connected. But they say it has to also have the capacity to profoundly transform societies and humanity. Otherwise, it's just an evolution. Right? If it has the power to transform humanity and society, then it's a revolution. So how many have there been? So where do you go to find out an answer to a question like that? You go to Wikipedia. This is the answer to that question. It'll come. Hopefully it'll come. If not, I'll have to just, there we go, it's coming. So this early one, financial revolution, there it was stocks and bonds, and the network was a physical network. A couple of industrial revolutions, if you think about it, those were, we invented engines that allowed us to travel faster, but then also the networks over which those things could travel. So those are the industrial revolutions. We created new ways of manufacturing as well. Scientific, technical, we started being able to signal things. Internet era, or information age, we started being able to send large amounts of data. And the era I'm going to talk about is this automation era where we can live more efficiently and create time. Think about it very simply this way. Financial era, we ship money. These are all shipping. And you're going to understand soon why I'm emphasizing the shipping. Shipping equals transportation. The first era is shipping of money. It was an easier vehicle for moving money around. Industrial era, shipping goods. Scientific, technical era was shipping bits. Information age, shipping bytes, gigabytes. We are in the knowledge shipping era. That's why this is a big deal. This is the era where we will ship knowledge over distances. So you think about my introduction, about saving time due to decreasing distance. It's about saving time due to increasing knowledge. So we're going to create a digital fabric, call it digital nervous system, that allows us to ship knowledge around, but not just ship it around for the fun of it, could be fun, but it's actually so we can take actions based on it. So there's got to be an outcome, and the outcome will be robotic things, drone-y things, autonomous things that help us perform those actions remotely. Okay, make sense? But to do that, we need to transform. So I'll briefly cover this, because everyone thinks that the internet was great so far, but if you really think about it, what has it done? It's increased what economists call well-being. Well-being means that your ability to do things in a relatively easy way. And I've already mentioned it. We could discover data. We could discover video and media content. We could discover each other, social networks. And then we did it faster with Snapchat. But if you really think about what I've just described to you, does that sound like a revolution? It sounds like convenience, which is what economists call well-being. So I'll argue we digitized, discovered, and shared stuff about us, and in the end, it was all about pictures of cats, which isn't really a revolution, let's be honest. So what we're entering is an era where it's a bit different, and this is the era. Think of it as the digitization, distribution, and optimization of our world, and that's the Industrial Revolution. So I would say we're going to, in future, have a consumer evolution. Yeah, we'll do more, we'll do 8K video, we'll do interesting entertainment, VR experiences, etc. Everything will be stored in the cloud so we can access it anywhere. You have more bandwidth on your mobile. You will use a Nokia 3310 as the new communicator. Did you all see that? Isn't it amazing? Yeah, that is part of Nokia, you know, in a weird way because it's a brand license, but still, that's how you're going to communicate in future, apparently. But most importantly, the world is going to change on the industrial side of things. We're going to actually digitize our world, and then consumers benefit. Give a quick example. I actually got rid of my Apple Watch because I didn't think it's a fantastic device. I now use this as a Withings watch, soon to be called Nokia. We bought this company called Withings. But what it does is physiological sensing, sends me messages, etc. This, as on its own, is a consumer device. But if it's tied to a healthcare service that is actually monitoring my physiology and optimizing and giving me alerts, then that I consider an industrial service because it's a healthcare service attached to a consumer device. So you see these two things are coupled, but the revolution is the automated healthcare service. It's not in these. These are just enablers of that. Okay, so that shows the two are coupled, but it's the industrial change that's the big deal, and consumers benefit. Okay, so So when you're thinking about innovating for the future, think, how could I change an industry, not how could I make a better Fitbit? Think that way, and you'll think bigger thoughts. So this is what I call Bell Labs thoughts. How could I change humankind in an industry, and then back it down to what is the thing I need to do? So I'm going to show you what you need to do. One is you need to minimize latency. One thing I've sort of alluded to is this things over a distance, right? Things over a distance. It turns out that when they're human things, this is at the bottom here, these things, these are human tasks. It turns out our brain can't actually process anything much faster than 100 milliseconds. If I'm speaking to you, you're typing, you're hearing, your brain takes about 100 milliseconds to process those signals, or sprint, or blink. So everything we've done, these are the applications, has basically taken, has been designed with 100 milliseconds in mind. However, when we enter the VR, AR era, when we enter the autonomous system era, when we enter very fine control era, we need 1 millisecond of latency, as the applications up here. Why does that matter? Speed of light. So it turns out I said I wasn't going to talk about relativity. I'm not, but I am going to show you that the speed of light matters. If I have a 100 milliseconds of time, light travels 10,000 kilometers. That means I can basically make applications that span the globe. If I have 1 millisecond of time for these applications, I can only go 100 kilometers. So you now know the other part of this answer is the distances that we're going to have to span are going to be much shorter in order to provide this new value, to create this new knowledge, to take these new actions. So everything is going to move from globally extended to localized, not because political reasons, nationalistic reasons, but because of the speed of light. So the future is about hyperlocal. Hyperlocal, where I will have a cloud, I will have a network, I will have knowledge, I will have applications and functions, and all my services will be rendered that way. And it's all because of the speed of light. Okay? So this is my sort of map of the future. I like to say applications of new value, charted here, bandwidth, latency. We've been living in this world. This is the world we've built so far. We thought it was great. It was the internet era. It was mostly comms related, web services related, social media related. Easy to do, though. It turns out that's easy to build. The other three dimensions are very high bandwidth. Think 360 video, et cetera. 360 video and VR, AR, which needs very low latency for the motion control. Haptic functions, autonomous system functions. All of those need very high bandwidth, low latency, brand new network. Okay. So the summary of what that network has to look like is this. This is what we've built so far. Hundreds of milliseconds of latency, tens of megabits per second. Your device had a battery life that lasted a day, unless it was the 3310 when it lasts a month. Did you see the numbers on how long that battery lasts for a month? It's amazing. $1,000 device, no, we're now at $50 devices and 10 billion of those. So this is the structure of the network, sort of centralized access, think of it as wireless, transport and core cloud. What we're going to is this world. We're going to sort of shove it all towards the edge. Everything will become hyper-localized. We're going to focus on things, and things are different. They need 1 millisecond of latency, many of those things, 1 gigabit per second for the very high bandwidth sort of VR, AR type experiences. The battery has to last 10 years. Now, why is that interesting? Because the only way I can actually make a battery last 10 years, even the Nokia 3310 only is a month, if I want the battery to last 10 years because it's in a remote location, it's not somewhere that can be powered, I have to put the function in the network. The only way to solve that problem optimally, yes, processors get more efficient, but still the right way to do it is put most of the application logic outside the device in the localized cloud, and the device really is just a signaling device. It's sending data back and forth to that edge cloud. That allows me to get the cost down as well, because once I've done that, I've got a very low cost device, and I need 1 trillion devices. I have to build networks for 1 trillion devices. So in summary, we have to build a brand new network. But it's not just about the network. So here's my new access network, my cloud, smart fabric, ways of controlling those systems, programmable interface on that network. But above that are these cognitive systems, new value platforms, and dynamic security and trust frameworks. All of that put together will create my new knowledge framework. And anyone who owns substantial value in any of these layers will be successful. But how do we judge value? So I'm going to end. How do we judge value? We judge value by the ability to save time. Okay? So anything you do in any one of these layers, whether it's a networking layer, a cognitive layer, a security or trust layer, or new digital value platforms, we think of those as the new Googles, the new Ubers, etc. has to save time to have fundamental value. Do that and you'll be massively successful. You may win a Nobel Prize, as we have done a few times at Bell Labs. So that's what I'm gonna leave you with, the answer to the conundrum. This is the analog world. We build the digital world. The digital world now adds value back into the analog world because that's what we want to do. We want to still live as analog species for the time being. And the whole goal of that is to create time. So thanks for your time. I think I'm out of time. I'll be around for the next 10, 15 minutes, but I hope you enjoyed the journey. And remember, it's all about saving time. Thanks very much.